Good evening. Welcome to the QCIS channel, formerly the Mind of STEM channel. The good old channel changed the name, but the information is still the same because I'm still giving you a daily dose of science, technology, engineering, and math. My name is Leon Jones, and what I'm going to do for the next segment of videos is I'm going to talk to you about how you become an engineer, particularly a civil engineer, because that's what I do. Now, there are certain requirements that you need to know. Now, what I'm going to do is give you some information on what you're going to need to be an engineer. Now, of course, being an engineer is not an easy profession. It's one of the hardest. Number of individuals don't make it in that field. Why? Because it's very math and science intensive. Now, you do have your university requirements. Now, again, I'm going to give you requirements on being a civil engineer. Now, the requirements for mechanical and electrical and chemical, they're basically the same, but you take different classes. But the main goal of being an engineer is you want to get licensed. Why do I say that? Because when you're licensed, you're able, if you're working for a company, to move up and basically name your price. You can become your own consulting firm. For the most part, you can actually stamp plans. And it's very important that you understand that. See, when you go to school and get an engineering degree, you come out and you get your experience. Now, I'm going to share my screen with you and show you what you need to become an engineer. All right. Again, how to become a civil engineer. Well, first of all, it starts with education. Now, again, civil engineers need a bachelor's degree in civil engineering or in civil engineering technology. Now, there are some states that you cannot become a licensed engineer with a civil engineering technology degree unless you have taken the civil engineering courses. And the courses have to be in calculus, science, just like regular engineers. Now, when you take courses in civil engineering, you're going to have to take calculus, statistics, engineering mechanics. Now, what do I mean by engineering mechanics? You have to take statics, dynamics, and mechanics of materials. Now, statics and mechanics of materials are very important in civil engineering. Dynamics, not as important because you're not dealing with matter that moves. I mean, you're dealing with matter that moves. You're dealing with angular momentum, centrifugal acceleration. More your mechanicals get into that because they're designing pulley systems. But when you are taking statics, well, you're going to have to do vectors in two dimensions and three dimensions. You're going to have to know some trigonometry. You're going to have to know some moments. You're going to have to know some equilibrium. So, and then when you get over to mechanics and materials, you're going to have to understand statically determinate structures and non-statically determinate structures, which in my humble opinion, there really is no such thing as a, it's called a statically indeterminate structure, and you have statically determinate structures. Let me correct myself. Well, when you have something that's statically indeterminate, that means you have more unknowns than moments. So what you're basically doing for that type of problem is you're creating a statically determinate structure, because if something is statically indeterminate, it's going to collapse. Now, you must have a degree that's accredited by ABET. ABET stands for the Accreditation Board for Engineering Technologies under the Engineering Accreditation Commission. Now, education is very important because you must obtain at least a bachelor's degree. Now, some of the qualities that you're going to need, you're going to need decision-making skills, leadership skills, math skills, organizational skills, problem-solving skills. You have to learn how to speak, and good writing skills. Now, again, here's where we start to get into the meat and potatoes. The licenses, certifications, and registrations. Now, again, as I gave you an overview, I'm going to break it down for you again. To be a civil engineer, you're going to need a degree from an accredited engineering program. I know I go to Purdue that has it. Now, engineering is a little different from other professions out there. Why? Because you have to take two exams. The first one is called an FE. That's the Fundamentals of Engineering Examination. Now, what that has on it, and I'm going to give you a few of the courses that are on the FE exam, and then I'm going to give you some that are on a PE exam, so you know exactly what you have to take. Now, you have to pass that FE examination. Now, if you don't pass, they give you a diagnostic score of what you missed. Now, also, the key to, once you graduate from school, you need to get at least 4 years of experience under your belt, and then you're able to take the PE exam. Now, let me show you what you need for the civil engineering exam. Let me share my screen again. All right. All right, now, you have NCES, they're the ones who give you your examination. Now, what I am giving you right now is a breakdown on what is on the civil FE examination. Now, you don't have to take the civil FE examination. You can take any one, but you got at least take the FE examination and pass. Now, what the FE examination is, it's a closed book exam. It used to be on pencil and paper, but now it's on computer. Now, the exam is 6 hours. It's actually 5 hours and 30 minutes with a half an hour break. You have 110 questions. Now, what I'm going to tell you about this exam, and I still have to take it as well, understand your units. You're going to have your U.S. customary units. And when I'm talking about units, I'm talking about units of length, width, height, and there's also metric, known as SI. Now, here's what you're going to need for the FE examination. And this is just a breakdown. Now, all exams are different during the exam cycle. But if you're going to take this examination, you're going to have to look at your mathematics and statistics. Again, you have to look at mathematics and statistics. Now, in this one section, out of 110 questions, you're going to have between 8 and 12 questions. In ethics and professional practice, you're going to have between 4 and 6 questions. Your engineering economics, you're going to have between 5 and 8 questions. And here's where you need to understand the meat and potatoes outside the math. Statics, you're going to have between 8 and 12 questions. And under statics, there's a breakdown on what you need to study for this examination. Dynamics, not so much, but you're going to have a little bit of problems. 4 to 6, again, unless you're going into mechanical engineering, you're going to very seldomly use anything like kinematics, force acceleration, because you're not moving anything. Statics is everything that's stationary, but you will need mechanics of materials. So when you do your shear and moment diagrams, now why are you going to need mechanics of materials? Mechanics of materials, you're going to have more circle on there. This course is very important because you're going to need to pass this course while you're in college so you can take structural analysis and soil mechanics. When you get into structural analysis, you're going to do shear and moment diagrams. You're also going to do stresses and strains like axial, torsion, bending, and shear, also in structural analysis. Now, when you get into stresses as well, more circle, that's when you're going to get into soil mechanics. Then, of course, you're going to have materials. You take a materials course in civil engineering, and what that materials course does, it teaches you about different construction materials like concrete, bituminous, aggregates. You're going to even have some mechanical properties of metals, concrete, asphalt, and wood, fluid mechanics. Now, why is fluid mechanics important? Because you may be designing hydraulic features, particularly like box culverts. You get into surveying. And I'm going to do a video on surveying because surveying is a little different, but you're going to have to take a licensing test for surveying as well. We do that one later on. I'll get into that because surveying and civil engineering have a direct reflection of one another. And also you're going to have to take water resources and environmental engineering. Now, again, when it comes to the FE examination, you can take any FE exam you want, but you got to pass it. Again, then you get into structural engineering, geotechnical engineering, transportation engineering, construction engineering. That's the meat and potatoes. Now, what happens if you pass that? Well, when you pass the FE examination and you get your 4 years of work experience, you take the what we call the PE examination. Now, very important that you understand the PE examination. Now, let me go back and get that information on the PE. Now, when it comes to civil engineering is one of the most diverse fields. So what I did, I pulled off a couple of exam specifications. I work in construction, so I'm going to show you the construction. There are other ones you have to get on the NCEES website to find all of these questions. Now, when you deal with your PE exam, they're going to be 80 questions. Now, something I forgot to tell you. The FE exam is a closed book exam. However, the PE exam is an open book exam. And of course, you still have to understand your units. Now, again, if you're going to take the construction part of civil engineering, you need to know project planning, means and methods, soil mechanics, course, structural mechanics. You also need to understand hydraulics and hydrology if you're going to be designing water resources and stormwater management. Understand curves if you're going to be dealing with traffic. Now, this is construction, but when it comes to all of civil engineering, you're going to have some general information in the field of civil engineering. Of course, you have to understand materials, site development, earthwork construction layout, and of course, estimating quantities and costs, construction operations and methods, scheduling, material quality control in production, temporary structures, health and safety. Now, again, one thing I will tell you about the PE, I heard it was easier than the FE. I don't believe that. What I will tell you, when you pass your PE, you get a stamp from your state. Now, each state is different. Now, your FE examination, of course, it is nationwide. Now, another question that might be posed to me, and I'll answer that right now. What if you get a master's degree? Well, each degree that you get, that's time off your work experience. So now if you come in and you want to take the FE examination with a master's degree, instead of having 4 years of work experience, you only need three. Now, I didn't do it, but I suggest everyone to take the FE examination while they're still in school, because the information is still fresh. Now, once you pass the PE, of course, you're going to have to pay a registration fee every 3 years to keep your license. Now, while you are keeping your license, you're going to take different PDHs, which are professional development hours. You have to have a certain number of them. And that's basically to keep reviewing all the technology and the specifications within your license, because you're going to have a lot of changes. And here are some of the titles that you'll use for the PE. And I like engineering. Engineering is a very good field. But most of all, you know, what I'm here to do is give you the requirements that you need, because most people don't understand what you need to be an engineer. Now, here's what I'm going to suggest too. If you really want to get some work experience and you're in college, try an internship as well. An internship will give you a feel of what civil engineering is about. Because in the end, they're always going to need infrastructure and they're always going to have a demand for engineers. That concludes the topic of requirements to be a civil engineer. If you like what I just presented, please comment, share, and of course, subscribe. And if you're looking for more of the social issues and the political content, check out my other channel, the 411 Talk Zone radio show. It's also on YouTube. Now, here's what I do for my channels. You cannot find me on YouTube. You can always find the 411 Talk Zone radio show and the QCIS channel on Twitter. And I go one step further with the QCIS channel, since it's a professional and educational channel. You can also find that channel on LinkedIn. And once again, thank you for listening to the QCIS channel. On this channel, you get a daily dose of science, technology, engineering, and math. Till next time, my name is Leon Jones. I want you all to have a wonderful and gracious evening.